Good evening. The world changed today for President Trump, and it could change even more tonight if and when Democrats, who now control the House, push through legislation to reopen the government. The White House has already threatened to veto it. We'll bring you that as it happens. For now, we'll focus on the longer term and potentially more serious consequence of Democrats in power. For the first time since taking office, President Trump is facing the prospect of real, extensive, and wide-ranging scrutiny from the opposition party led by a highly disciplined adversary.
And to the Speaker of the House, Nancy Pelosi, I extend to you this gavel. Thank you.
That happened at about 2:30 Eastern time. About 90 minutes later, markets closed with the Dow Industrials nearly 700 points lower on the day. On top of that, the government shutdown entered its 13th day. All in all, a very sobering day. So what did the president do in the wake of it all? Well, he made a surprise appearance in the White House briefing room with leaders of a Border Patrol officer union who praised him on his wall. It was billed as a press conference, but neither he nor Press Secretary Sarah Sanders took any questions, making it something of a stunt. He also put up another one of those weird Game of Thrones movie-type posters of himself on Instagram, this one saying, "The wall is coming," which is the subject for The Ridiculous a little bit later tonight. We'll also talk later about whether movie posters and briefing cameos are just shiny objects to distract from more serious matters, like the not-so-shiny, very real bottom line the president now faces, a whole new world for him, one in which the Speaker of the House is a member of the opposition party, and she's not ruling out impeachment.
We shouldn't be impeaching for a political reason, and we shouldn't avoid impeachment for a political reason. So we just have to see how it comes.
She says she wants to go slow, but the new Democratic chairman of the House Armed Services Committee, Adam Smith, says it's not too soon to be talking about it. His colleague today, Congressman Brad Sherman, actually took the step of introducing articles of impeachment, which makes him an outlier for now. But it does underscore how potentially serious this could get for the president, who, as you know, is now being investigated along with his company and his now defunct charity by Robert Mueller's team, by the Southern District of New York, by the New York Attorney General. And now you can add Congressman Elijah Cummings' House Oversight Committee to that mix, and the House Judiciary Committee, now chaired by Jerry Nadler, who's long been calling for more investigation.
We have to find out exactly what was going on. We have to look at the Russian interference with the campaign and what did the president know about that and to what extent did he cooperate with that. If he did, we have to look at his business dealings and his lying about that. We have to look at the fact that he surrounded himself with crooks, and we have to get to the bottom of this.
Well, today he took a step in that direction, introducing legislation to protect Special Counsel Mueller. He told Armando Raju he wants to hear from Acting Attorney General Matt Whitaker whether he's willing or not.
Still trying to get a date. They're
drinking
the
feet
on a date.
Mm-hmm.
We'll see what happens.
Will you send a subpoena to him if he doesn't?
We will if we have to.
And now, for the first time in the Trump presidency, the opposition party has subpoena power. Whatever you think of the acting attorney general or the president for that matter, it's a far cry from the days when a chairman of the House Intelligence Committee who's friendly to the White House can go to the White House, get talking points from someone there, and then later pretend to have just briefed the president on the very same White House talking points.
Today I briefed the president on the concerns that I had about incidental collection and how it relates to President-elect Trump and his transition team and the concerns that I have. What I've read bothers me, and I think it should bother the president himself and his team.
Well, the White House friendly Devin Nunes no longer runs the Intelligence Committee. Congressman Adam Schiff does, and just about an hour ago, he made news saying he's preparing for a committee vote to send the unredacted transcripts from all their interviews to Special Counsel Mueller. Again, you can see the change of power in the House is a good thing or a bad thing, but good or bad, one thing is beyond debate. It is now a different world politically for this president and this administration. We'll, of course, bring you the House budget vote tonight when it happens, but first, some perspective from California Democratic Congressman Eric Swalwell, who serves on the Intelligence and Judiciary Committees. I spoke to him just a short time ago. Congressman, today Speaker Pelosi said that the incoming House will be, quote, for the people. Do you think voters are going to view multiple investigations into the president as for the people?
Well, it'll be for a balance of power on many abuses of power that we've seen in the past, but we can't miss the opportunity to also do what they sent us here, which was to collaborate on infrastructure, passing the DREAM Act, having background checks, and reforming prescription drugs. And Anderson, those are all things that Donald Trump said he wanted to do, including even at last year's State of the Union, but a Republican Congress never brought forward. So we're going to put that forward, but we're also not going to shirk our oversight responsibilities.
Some of your fellow Democrats on the House Judiciary Committee introduced legislation to protect the Mueller investigation. Okay. Even if that bill were to pass in the full House, McConnell has made it clear he doesn't see a need for it, won't bring it to the Senate floor for a vote. So is a House vote anything more than just symbolic? Does it matter?
Well, we also hope that it will build momentum on the Senate side, that vulnerable senators will see that the will of the American people is that they want this investigation protected, and that it'll, you know, it's already passed in a bipartisan vote on the Senate Judiciary Committee and hopefully would come to a full vote. But Mitch McConnell, by not allowing this come forward, is suppressing the will of the majority of his own members. And so I think it's going to take outside voices. You saw today Cory Gardner's already coming forward talking about ending the shutdown by not having wall approval. And he's in a tight seat. There's other Republican senators in a similar fashion. So I think you're going to see pressure build.
But do you think this is what we're going to see a lot of over the next 2 years, bills that pass the Democratic-led House and yet really have no chance at all of passing a Republican-led Senate?
Well, I think a lot of what we're going to do is just purely protect. Protect health care from being cut even further, the protections that were put in place by the Affordable Care Act. Protect paychecks from, you know, seeing tax cuts go only to the top and not to working families. And protect against corruption. And yes, advance, as I said, on transportation, prescription drugs, background checks where we can. But also, it's going to be the 2020 field, I think, that's going to really put forward what a, you know, Democratic priorities will be if we have the House and the Senate in 2021.
As mentioned earlier, fellow House Democrat of yours took the step today of introducing articles of impeachment against the president. Is that a smart move in your opinion, or do you think it's counterproductive at this point?
It's not a move that I support. This president, Anderson, may be impeached, but we're certainly not there with the evidence. We are going to, you know, look where Republicans were unwilling to look before and build an airtight case if that's what's necessary, seek bipartisan buy-in, and make sure if we go that way, the American people understand why. But we should not be as reckless with the facts as Donald Trump is, and we should give him probably a fairer investigation than he deserves.
Well, just lastly, the upcoming vote on the Intelligence Committee to send Mueller its unredacted interview transcripts. What do you expect Mueller to learn from them that he doesn't already know?
Well, he'll see that in the basement of the House Intelligence Committee are just boxes of transcripts that have lies of witnesses who came before us, were not straightforward. Some of them, like Roger Stone, have had to amend their testimony over and over because of free press reporting that showed that he wasn't straightforward. And so I hope those witnesses are held accountable and that it helps Bob Mueller's investigation. Mm.
Congressman Swalwell, appreciate your time. Thanks.
My pleasure.
So we're seeing divided government play out tonight as we speak, and challenges to the president have been coming all day. I want to talk about it. CNN chief legal analyst and former federal prosecutor Jeffrey Toobin joins me. Also USA Today columnist and CNN political analyst Kirsten Powers and former Republican senator and presidential candidate Rick Santorum. Jeff, you heard Congressman Swalwell talk about the very real consequences when the Intelligence Committee turns over those unredacted witness testimony. Do you buy that?
Yes, I think it is significant. I don't know if any of those statements will be proven to be false, but you could not bring a criminal case without the actual transcript. So it is an indispensable, it is a necessary but not sufficient step for Mueller to bring these cases. And it's only logical, it's only fair for him to have these to do a complete investigation.
Senator Santorum, how worried would you be if you're the president and you don't have an ally like Devin Nunes running the House Intelligence Committee anymore?
Look, I mean, this for the president, this comes down to two things. Number one, impeachment, and the House is going to do what the House is going to do. The Senate will never, at least given the current state of play right now, is not going to come anywhere close to impeaching the president. The second is simply things that they can do to harass the president. And this is one of those harassment things. I mean, it's not going to touch the president. There are people that may have said things that under oath that turned out to be wrong. Again, that doesn't really do anything other than create more smoke, but no real fire for the president.
Kirsten, do the Democrats in the House should be cautious on how they approach the prospect of impeachment? And we've talked about this before. In our next hour, we're going to speak with the Congressman Jerry Connolly, who's now in the majority of the House Oversight Committee. And he says he's already seen enough just with the president being an unindicted co-conspirator in the Cohen filing.
Look, I mean, Donald Trump is obviously extremely unpopular with the base of the Democratic Party. And so it's understandable that there are people who want him out of office any way possible and, you know, are letting their passion probably get a little ahead of themselves and not considering that the kind of blowback that can come from these kinds of actions. And we've seen this in history when there has been overreach. So I think the position that Nancy Pelosi has staked out, which is really the position of the Democratic Party at this point, is you need to wait for the investigation. And if we get to a point where you have a president who's been indicted, for example, then yes, you should start looking at possibly impeaching him. But I don't think based on what they have in front of them at this point, that there are any impeachable offenses that at least, you know, as far as I think the average American will look at it, would feel it would be appropriate to be doing.